We've just finished up the negotiations. What is your assessment of the final outcome of COP16 here in Cancun?
I think the COP16 has come up finally with some decisions. They have adopted decisions on issues which we have long been fighting for. And of course, one of the in the decision, especially the long-term cooperative action text, they have two references to the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples, recognizing the importance of this, the relevance of this declaration, to help address the issues of climate change mitigation and adaptation. We have one under the text on reducing emissions from deforestation and forest degradation, which says that the rights and knowledge of indigenous peoples and local communities have to be respected in all RED activities, and the UN Declaration, and it notes that the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples has been adopted by the UN General Assembly. Surprisingly, we had another one that was included in economic and social consequences of response measures. And in that particular section, it says, noting the relevant provisions of the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples. This is very important because, you know, the UN Declaration is just a declaration. It's not a legally binding agreement, although most of what it contains are really legally binding as contained in the conventions on human rights. But now that it is being integrated into in legally binding instruments like the Framework Convention on Climate Change, as well as the Convention on Biological Diversity, increasingly it's gaining a status of international customary law. So that is one of the objectives that we had when we came here and took part in all the different UNFCCC activities that culminated in Cancun, no, for this year. So I think from an indigenous people's perspective, we are really satisfied with the results, mainly because it does contain references to human rights. Never has the Climate Change Convention document or results have come up with such a direct link between climate change and human rights. But because of the indigenous people's strong advocacy within the process, as well as other civil society groups, we succeeded in putting this thing. So that's one of my assessments. Secondly, it has also contained, of course, references to the vulnerabilities, the particular vulnerabilities of indigenous peoples, who indeed are most vulnerable because they belong to, and they stay in the most fragile ecosystems in the world, and therefore any change in the climate will affect not only their livelihoods, not only their resources, but their cultures as well. Because our cultures are very strongly linked with the lands where we stay, or the waters that we depend our survival on. So this text contains the importance of indigenous knowledge, both again in the RED, as well as in adaptation, as well as in technology transfer, and also in mitigation. No, so it sort of cuts across the different sections of the agreement. And then thirdly, it does recognize the need for full and effective participation of indigenous peoples, of course, and other stakeholders. And as we have always been saying since the start of the UNFCCC, there is really a need to ensure that kind of participation, because they are talking about issues that are directly linked to our very survival as distinct peoples and cultures, but they are not including us. We are always excluded, no? And so we fought every inch of the way to be able to be included. And we succeeded in fact, even our partners, we have partners in 10 countries in the world, we have now 6 indigenous persons, I know more than, I think, 10 who come from 6 countries, so are now part of the government delegation, which is a very big step for us, because now we are a part of the negotiating process. We are not just there trying to influence the negotiators. We became negotiators ourselves, no? So that is really one thing. But we are not so completely happy about it, no? Because the agreements on the Kyoto Protocol are not so strong. Of course, they did not succeed, though. The countries who are against the Kyoto Protocol, who wanted to kill it, did not succeed in killing it, no? So there is still a whole bunch of agreements on Kyoto Protocol. But there was no clear very, you know, very explicit reference to the need for a second commitment period. The numbers are still not satisfactory, you know, in terms of the global goals, the goals and the legally binding commitments that the annex, that these industrialized countries are giving. But I think that that can still be worked on the way to Durban. So in general terms, those are my own assessments, and I think as an indigenous caucus and indigenous persons in the different arenas, whether in the negotiating area, outside, you know, have really worked very well together, and I'm so proud of that.
Wonderful. So Durban is where the COP17 will be next year, and they'll continue the negotiations. Can you tell us a little bit about your organization, TEBA?
Yes, TEBA is an Indigenous Peoples Organization that I'm the founder. I'm the key founder. We founded this in 1996. And our main intent is to really help build our own capacities, indigenous people's capacities, to be able to effectively advocate for the changes that they would like in relation to laws or programs, but also to fight for the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples, and now that it has been adopted, to make sure that this becomes really a framework that will guide governments in terms of how they are working with indigenous people. So we are working very strongly on how to implement the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples. Now we have been working with, we work with different indigenous organizations in different countries. Now we have, they are direct partners meaning that we work with them, we plan together with them, we generate resources that they can use, you know, for their own work. So we have now partners in 10 countries in the world, you know.
And you're training them and empowering them to advocate for themselves.
Exactly. We're training them to be the ones to speak for themselves, to do the research for themselves, to articulate their own perspectives, and to bring them to all these arenas where their voices have to be heard. So that is our role, and that is what we have been doing since we were established.
Vicky, do you have any final words for the folks back home?
Well, I think for instance, you come from the United States, and the United States still has really not been a very positive player in the climate change convention. And of course, they are the last country now that has yet to endorse the adoption of the UN Declaration. So I wish that they really are sincerely moving towards endorsing this, and I look forward to seeing them announcing this during the next session of the UN Permanent Forum on Indigenous Issues, which will be held in May 2011. I also wish that the citizens in the United States really push hard and pressure very hard the government, because I believe that this is your major role as a people, no? I mean, I don't think that you really should be doing a lot of things for other people in the world. The biggest contribution that you can give to all the oppressed and marginalized and colonized peoples of the world, of which your government has contributed to, I think the best contribution is for you to really strengthen the movements in the United States, because the moment you are strong and your voice is really being heard by the governments, then the government will change. Then that's the biggest gift you can give to all the peoples of the world, and in particular indigenous peoples. So I think that's the, I really believe that as you as citizens, your role is to really raise the awareness of your own citizenry, make them more vigilant and active in terms of pressuring your government, because after all, you're supposed to be the biggest democracy in the world.
Well, thank you very much, Vicky, and good luck and a safe journey home.
Thank you very much, and I also wish you luck in all the work that you are doing. I believe all these little efforts being done to get views of people and bring this into the U.S. is really going to be very important for us. And I think that's what solidarity really means. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay.